Welcome to Category 5 Technology TV. What you're about to experience is a free, worldwide interactive broadcast from Ontario, Canada. We broadcast live every Tuesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Get your questions in. Join the community chat room at www.category5.tv or email us at live@category5.tv. And now, let's begin. Here's your host, Robbie Ferguson.
Welcome to episode number 247 of Category 5 Technology TV. It's Tuesday, the 12th of June, 2012. And I'm Robbie Ferguson.
I'm Hillary Rumble. Greetings, everybody.
Greetings. Chris Wright, good to see you. Pyrus Rock, old guy Jim. We got a bunch of friends in the chat room there. Category 5 on Freenode, Mathman 47. Hey, Dave Maydu. Good to see you.
Greetings, GWG. Everyone.
Thibod, John Zim. And so it begins. Michael Iowa, how you been?
I'm pretty great. Yeah? Keeping it real. Been busy, but...
Always keeping it real with Hillary Rumble.
Yeah, it's my catchphrase or something. No, things are good.
What are you keeping busy with these days?
Well, you know, I'm getting married, so... Getting
still just
that's
the preparations for
crazy.
That, like leading up to that.
Yeah.
For like...
Till it happens.
It's like, yeah. Just getting it done.
There's something every day, so been busy.
You've got a lot of support from your family and friends.
Oh,
and
yeah.
So,
for
love
sure.
Seeing the photos and stuff. Hey, you should follow Hillary on Twitter, simply Hillary Rumble. And, of course, I'm Robbie Ferguson, if you care to follow me, too. I appreciate your follows.
Pretty easy to remember
us on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the Category 5 TV Twitter account as well. Category 5 TV. That's where you're going to get all the stuff that's non-personal, that's just like shows coming up,
yes.
What we're going to be featuring, who's going to be on the show, that kind of stuff. Following us personally, of course, you're going to hear about my kids and my barbecue. You're going to see delicious items from my kitchen and I guess some photos of Hillary wearing
strange
outfits from the 70s.
You never know what'll happen, I tell you.
You never know.
The internet's a magical place.
Yeah, Dave Maydu says, hey... Thibod congratulating you on the engagement.
Thanks, guys.
Chat room going wild. Old guy Jim wants to know, when is the date?
Well, if I tell you the actual date, I'm worried you're all going to show up, and I only have
There's not enough chicken.
So it's this August.
But the gifts. Think of all the gifts.
Oh, true. I mean, if you're willing to send me some presents, then maybe
60,000 toasters. You know?
Maybe I can save a plate for you.
Yeah, well, stick around. We're going to be talking about postcards in just a minute. And if you care to, I mean, hint, you could send her a card and say congratulations or whatever.
Get out of town.
Yeah, it's always nice. It's always nice.
What else is nice is the news, because it tells us the exciting, wild stuff that's happening in the world of technology. As such, a security advisory is warning users of last.fm to change their password. Ooh.
Okay.
A newly developed material may help capture and store CO2. New smart pump transmitters will soon help 70 villages in Kenya to keep their hand water pumps in good repair. And lastly, iOS 6 will drop Google Maps in favor of Apple's own mapping technology. So stick around, because these stories are coming up later in the show.
Brilliant. Yeah, Dave Maydu, what a guy. A couple of people in the chat room say, hey, can we see the ring?
Want to check out the rock?
You want to check out the rock? Here, I got...
Okay,
let's
get our little handy hand cam. Dun, da, da, da.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
It's my ring.
Yeah.
There you go.
Very nice. Very nice.
Symbol of my love.
And his love.
Yes.
Yes. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, folks, tonight is, of course, a viewer question extravaganza.
Ooh.
I feel like I want to, like, bring in, like, a reverb chamber or something when I say that. Viewer, question, extravaganza.
I like your sound effects.
You like
for that?
That?
You could just do your own. You don't need...
It's pretty all right.
You don't need anything else. It's all you.
Yeah. Yeah. We've got a ton of your questions to cover tonight.
We do.
We have received your questions. You can email us live@category5.tv. You can also join us in the chat room, as many are right now. We love to receive your questions And Hillary is going to do her best to field as many as possible tonight.
Yes.
But before we get into that, we did get a postcard.
We did.
Very good. Thank you for sending in your postcard.
Yes, a postcard that came to us in an envelope.
Dans l'enveloppe.
I will open it and read it.
The only thing about getting a postcard in an envelope is that it doesn't get the stamp on the postcard, so then
that's
we take
true.
It out. And,
well,
and
maybe cut our little
maybe
stamp.
Maybe cut the stamp off. Or we'll
save vanishing species.
I will do that.
Do you want to get a shot of this bad boy?
Oh, yeah. Let's
coming
let's
to us from St. Paul, Minnesota. Dear Cat 5 crew, greetings from St. Paul, Minnesota. A longtime viewer and a Linux user, I have been watching the show for over 2 years. Last year, joined by my 7-year-old son, who is also a Linux user.
Oh, hold on.
Whoops.
Ho, ho! Thanks, folks.
Sorry, I'm like trying to line this up and also read it.
There we go.
Okay, sweet. We truly love...
Okay, start at the top. Sorry, they didn't hear you because the microphone was bad.
Oh.
In that shot. New hand cam, folks.
Sorry.
There you go. My fault. So
okay.
they didn't hear you when we were joking.
Wow.
All the funny things that I said when you were showing the ring. Okay, go ahead.
Okay.
There you go.
Whoops. All right. Start from the top. Oh dear. Dear Cat 5 crew, greetings from St. Paul, Minnesota. A longtime Linux user, I have been watching the show for over 2 years. Last year, joined by my 7-year-old son, who is also a Linux user. We truly love the show. It seems you're likely to grow, but please do not change much. The show is perfect the way it is. Looking forward to your next episode, Bartek and Micolage.
Cheers. Yeah, we've been growing like crazy over here, but I've been cutting down on my carbohydrates, so hopefully that will nip that in the bud.
Not growing in that regard.
The show has been growing exponentially. You see it more than maybe the viewers, because you as viewers, you're going to see things as they gradually happen. Mm-hmm. But here, of course, we've got the excitement of constantly going through changes and rebuilding things and getting ready for some of the exciting things that we have in store for season 6, which is coming up.
Crazy.
But I think one of the things that we're very keen on here at Category 5, myself, the co-hosts, yourself, it boils down to it's all about the viewers. So, you know, we do our best to have fun with it, present some cool hardware and gear and stuff like that. But really, when it boils down to what is what the substance of the show is, it's about hanging out with our community, having a good time, answering your questions as best as we can. And because of that, I think that, you know, we can get better and better. We can get better picture. We can get better sound. We can make it so that when we bring up the hand cam, the audio works. And, you know, so there's this progression toward awesomeness. But the show still remains the same as far as the actual substance. So bigger space would be good. Hey, as we grow.
You don't know
you guys don't see, but we can actually touch this. Like, that's right there. Right?
It's not like a...
And this is right here. Like, we're that... I can touch both sides of the studio sitting in my place. But it works.
It does work.
It works.
You guys wouldn't even know unless we pointed that out.
Hmm. Yeah.
So
thank you very much for your postcard. Hey, Hillary, how can they send in their postcards?
You can send us your postcards and anything else you may or may not want to send our way.
Hint, hint.
To Category 5 Technology TV, PO Box 29009, Barrie, Ontario, and that's, of course, in Canada, L4N7W7. Looking forward to getting your stuff in the mail.
Your stuff.
Yeah.
I like Star Trek books. Gadget Wisdom Guru, GWG, has sent me a couple.
That's so
bless his
fun.
Soul. Oh,
that's
it's
so,
so fun.
Nice.
Yeah.
I love that. Pretty sweet. What a great community of viewers, I tell ya.
Yeah, you sure are. And once in a while, I'll send you something. You know, I got a Magic Jack to give away next week, folks. So don't forget to give us a call. 2545-228588 is the number to call. Tell us why you want a Magic Jack, and I will reciprocate the postcards and the Star Trek books and the congratulations on your engagement things that you send.
True, yes.
We'll reciprocate with the Magic Jack if you win. How's that sound?
Sounds good to me. I like it.
Cool. Well, we do have to take a quick break. Before we do, I'll just mention, you know, bring up our mobile site. Get onto that site with your mobile device. Very cool stuff. And yeah, do that. We're out of time for this bit, but we'll be right back after this.
At
At EcoAlkalines, we believe you should be able to trust your batteries not just here, but here, here, and here. But with one exception, you should also be able to trust your batteries here. EcoAlkalines are the world's first and only certified carbon-neutral battery manufactured to the highest standards of recycling and quality, without any trace amounts of harmful chemicals like mercury, lead, or cadmium. EcoAlkalines provide performance that rivals leading national alkaline battery brands at a comparable price. Find out more about the EcoAlkalines difference. EcoAlkalines.com.
You are watching Category 5 TV, and we are a member of the Tech Podcast Network. If it's tech, it's here. And the International Association of Internet Broadcasters.
Do you find that hard to say? International Association of Internet.
Yeah.
Broadcasters.
I thought I was going to say Internet.
Getting used to it.
I like it.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be a part of these associations and groups of other broadcasters. They're really almost like social groups for broadcasters where we're able to feed off of other people's knowledge and even share a little bit of our own with the groups. And so it's very nice to be a part of both of those groups.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're watching and you're part of that association, nice to have you here. Thank you. Well, viewer question extravaganza is coming up in just a moment. We are going to be looking at tonight, if you're interested at all in hardware, gear, we have a very cool device from Thermaltake. Now, they've been out of, where did all their liquid cooling stuff go? It kind of vanished, like the Big Water that I run. I love that device, but it's really hard to find these days. Mm-hmm. Now they're bringing it back onto their website. Now they've got the new Water 2.0. We're going to be looking at this in just a few minutes. We're going to do an unboxing, which is crazy awesome. I'm going to show you why the Water 2.0 from Thermaltake is perhaps the coolest liquid cooling system that you've seen in a long time.
All right.
So stick around. All right. It's time for your questions.
Whoa. First one of the night.
Yeah.
Coming to us from John Crisp.
John Crisp.
Hi, nice Robbie and crew.
Hey.
Sure hope you can direct and advise me on this problem.
Sure.
No sound in Ubuntu 12.04.
None.
He's included in this email his stats,
Okay.
which I will not read. However,
bring it up.
He indicates that Ubuntu detects the audio.
Yes.
But then it says, did Ubuntu make 12.04 incompatible with my ICH6?
Specifically, they did. Yeah, they said.
They did it for you.
Let's make Ubuntu 12.04 incompatible with John Crisp's system.
Yeah, sorry. Win some, you lose some, right?
That's how they work, you know?
So he's saying, oh, his ICH6 HD audio card family. How does
that
one
tells me something.
Interpret
okay.
and then read this stuff? So he's pasted it all below. He says,
has he ever?
He says, it takes a geek such as you. Thanks, Robbie.
Oh.
You're my last hope. No other forums have addressed this issue.
I was just about to say, I understand what he's saying here, and then he ended it with that.
Calling you a geek?
Calling me an uber geek. Which I suppose is all right.
I think it's a compliment, you know?
You think so?
I do.
That's nice.
I wish I were an uber geek, unfortunately. I just read the questions. I don't answer them.
This is a fair bit of
info.
Jargon. Yeah, and I'm just double checking. I've copied and pasted from the email just to hide your mask your email address there, John. But look at all this.
Would you look at that? A whole other language there.
So by the way, John, our email system has removed all line wraps and indentations from your email. So what do we need? One of the things that stood out to me as Hillary was reading that was that was this, that you're using this HDA Intel driver. And that tells me, and I'm just looking through here. Yeah, hey, your host name gives me a little bit of a hint here as to what the problem may be. So thanks for doing that. Look at your graphics. VirtualBox graphics. You're using a virtual machine, my man. So what's different about a virtual machine is it's not real hardware. This is virtual hardware, and you're using the wrong hardware type. The particular hardware type that you're using for your virtual machine is designed for kind of like 3D audio digital output, like for the optical output. So let's bring up a virtual machine just to confirm here. I've got here I am in VirtualBox with Ubuntu 12.04, and I do have, it should work just the same as yours, right? So here's the thing. Everything looks good as far as audio goes. You can see when you go into sound settings, and it's just taking a moment to boot up here. Okay, here we go, John. What do we got? Right? So this is what I'm seeing. You're probably seeing something similar because we're both using that HDA Intel virtual hardware. So what we need to do, let's shut down this virtual machine, okay? Because I understand that you are using a virtual machine, and so it's important just to make sure that that's configured correctly. Thing is, a virtual machine will tap into your real hardware, so no matter what your real hardware is, you don't need to emulate as the same thing. You can emulate a Sound Blaster 16 if you want, whatever you want to do. It's virtual, so we can fake this thing out. Let's open up the settings for that virtual machine now. Let's go over to audio, and now just change your audio controller here to, I would say, an AC97 card, which is just a standard analog card. Let's start with that one, John. Hit OK, boot up the machine. Here it goes, and we're going to see if audio works now. We'll let that boot up.
I was just in the zone. I'm just reading the email, so I was just trying to see what exciting stuff we have next. So, sorry, I was kind of in the zone. This is extraordinaire. Oh my goodness, what am I trying to say?
Making up words now.
Forget about it.
Here on the show.
Oh boy.
I think it's coming up.
Here we go.
Oh, there we go. Okay. Now you tell me if you hear anything. I'm gonna log in. Oh, did you hear that? This time we had sound. And?
Here we go.
What's going to happen? There it is. Okay, I'm going to bring back up my sound settings here. And let's see what we have. Okay. Now you see we've got totally different audio hardware. Looks good. Now you notice as I booted up there that I actually had sound that time.
Mm-hmm.
So if I bring up my browser and go over to, you know, a website that plays audio or something like that. Ah, cool. Category 5 YouTube. Let's do that. Oh. TV. Not that TV. There we go. YouTube.com/Category5TV. And if I push play, John, because we've changed the audio hardware. Virtual audio hardware. There we go.
It works.
Welcome to. So basically what we've done there is we've done the equivalent with a virtual machine, which is brilliant because it's so easy to do. We've taken out that incompatible hardware and we've put in a new sound card. This AC97 card. And your system doesn't know any better because it's just piping through your regular sound card anyways. So that should work for you. All right, John?
Give it a whirl.
Yeah, give
Let
it a try.
Let us know.
Let us know how it goes.
That's what we're here for, you know?
Thanks so much for your question, John.
Well, I have come across another question that is kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
It's more about the history of Category 5.
Ah.
This comes to us from Hong Zhang. Hopefully I've said your name right.
Hey there.
Hi, Robbie. I am a Chinese college student. Several months ago, I was in Germany. And during that time, I discovered Category 5 Technology TV through the internet. And I fell in love with the show instantly. But what's really frustrating is that after I got back to China, I can't watch the show anymore. Even though I can still access your website and read the notes, I think it's because of some of the networking policies of mainland China. The same reason I can't access YouTube or Facebook. So now my only solution is to ask some of my friends in Hong Kong to download the show and send it to me weekly. Anyway,
yeah, that's sad, eh?
Sorry for the complaint, but here's the real question. I'm very curious what the name of the show actually means. How did you come up with the name Category 5 Technology TV? Is the number 5 referring to something specific? Thanks.
Do you have any idea where Category 5 might come from?
Hurricane?
No.
Just kidding.
Actually.
I don't know. I never thought about it, to be honest.
Hongzhang, the cable that you use for your networking, so this is an RJ45 connector on a Category 5 cable. So that's 100 megabits. That was before gigabit came out. I mean, we've been doing this since 2005, believe it or not. The show actually started live in 2007, so we were doing it for 2 years before the actual live broadcast started. Mm-hmm. And we had a list of basic names that we could choose from, had a bit of a focus group with family and friends, and said, okay, what names sound good? What names do you like? And Category 5 Technology TV was the one that that got the most votes from just a list of names that we had thought up. But originally, it started with Category 5 Cable, and our old logo, you'll remember, had that Category 5 wrapped around it.
Yeah.
And the RJ45 on the end. And then we had thought, well, maybe we'd play on that, and you know, each episode would have five general topics in the episode.
Okay.
So it'd be five categories, Category 5. So it's kind of like a play on terms. But then the show took off. We kept the name because we've got the domain and it's a popular show, so we're not going to go changing the name halfway through. But it works.
All right. So,
but that's the origination.
Cool.
Interesting to hear that you were in Germany and caught the show. Check out viewership all in the area here. These are just, you'll notice that, like, these are the people that are pretty much, you know, on our site within the past little bit. This isn't like all time. This is just kind of current stuff. Beautiful, wonderful to have so many people watching from Germany, United Kingdom, Poland, and Ukraine, all across here. And you'll see now we're starting to see some of you in China as well, especially on the coast there. So what it looks like now, understand that mainland China is behind what we here in Canada call the Great Firewall of China. It's a blockade that is meant to prevent social uprising by blocking Western video channels and chat channels and your ability to participate in YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, those kinds of things. So it becomes a problem for people like us who are trying to offer you a service.
For sure.
We want to offer this to you free of charge, and we want this to be a global thing. After all, it's the World Wide Web. And there's nothing about Category 5 that in and of itself is...
Particularly...
We're not political, really.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I'll tell you to, you know, buy this device over this device. I mean, but it really is neither here nor there when it comes to politics. But the fact is that... Because we need to keep our costs low, we have to host on some of these third-party services that unfortunately are blocked by your government. So that means YouTube, our YouTube channel, you can't access it in China. Our actual video on demand, our RSS feeds are hosted on Blip TV. Unfortunately, that's also blocked. Right? So what's really good, though, and I have good news for you, and this is what I'm leading up to, is that we've been planning this for some time. I've been planning it for some time. With our new website, which is launching on July 1st and about to go into Phase 3 beta on this Friday, we are launching what's called the alternative feeds for our site. What that means is that you're going to be able to, from China, from anywhere in the world, if you have any trouble accessing our main feeds, which are hosted on Blip TV and all these things, you're going to actually be able to use our alternate feed and tap into videos that are hosted on our servers. Because we're not blocked. It's these third-party services that are blocked.
Gotcha.
The downside of that is it's extremely expensive. We're talking about 650 gigabytes of video in order to host what we've done so far. So there is that. And so we do, you know, we appeal for donations if you decide to use those feeds. But really, it's about reaching the entire globe with Category 5. I'm very excited to be launching this, especially for those of you in China who are perhaps downloading this in Hong Kong and taking it across the border. You can read more about it on my blog, which is actually baldnerd.com. So head on over to baldnerd.com and you'll be able to read all about our launching into China with our alternate feeds. But that's coming July 1st. Very, very excited about that.
Whoa.
And that goes for anyone who's having trouble with accessing those feeds.
Mm-hmm.
it's going to be available. We also intend, intend to program into the system that if you choose alternate feeds, if it detects that you're from mainland China, it's going to automatically give you a different pop-up player as well that's going to tap into no third-party services.
Oh, I see.
Understand that the disadvantage here for us, as far as cost goes, of course, our cost goes up because we have to host it.
Right.
But also because we have to be careful that we don't use any third-party services because they're probably blocked by the Chinese government, it means we can't put any advertising on it because the ad servers are blocked.
Oh,
right.
Okay,
we can't tap into any of we are able to offset a lot of the expense for Category 5 by the ads that you see, by the commercials, by, you know, when you launch a video on our website, it plays a little 30-second commercial that you can skip if you want. But if you watch it and you click on it, we get a little reciprocation from that. We won't be able to include those on our alt feeds.
Gotcha.
So it's a bit of a scary adventure into that, but I trust that it's going to go very, very well, and we appreciate everybody's support. But Hong Zhang, very excited to be bringing it directly to you, and so I hope that you enjoy the show.
Yes.
And spread the word in mainland China. We're seeing that it is growing there, and as I said, the East Coast there is. It looks like people are starting to tap into Category 5. And truth be told, the alternate feeds are now available in mainland China.
Cool.
We're merging that into there, but our main website won't see it until July 1st.
All right.
Yeah.
Happy Canada Day to us, and happy world distribution to you.
There you go.
Cool. Thanks for your email. Have another quick email here coming to us from Amikai in Israel.
Hey there.
A while back, you've mentioned that you are preparing some kind of Category 5.tv desktop app that will keep us up to date and enable us to watch the show both live and past episodes. I'd like to have such an app, similar to maybe Minitube, to be able to watch all the shows and tag the ones that I've already seen as watched and so on. Is there one out there?
It was really well in the works, this Category 5 app. And as we were developing it, that's when HTML5 and H.264 video streaming made the switch. So we lost in order to go forward, we would have had to recode a lot of stuff.
Primarily you.
So,
yes.
Yes. So yeah. I'm not opposed to, you know, perhaps after the big launch on July 1st, maybe we can go back to that. And if there's a demand for it, you know, pop us an email. And certainly after July 1st, that's a good time to motivate me to do some coding for that kind of thing. I think it's a really cool idea, a desktop app that you can actually launch just from your start menu or your applications menu that brings up Category 5. Whether or not it's necessary with the new V3 website, that will be up to you. Mm-hmm. Maybe when you've seen the website, you'll say, oh my goodness, it's amazing. It's so zippy and fast and awesome.
You will.
You
I
might.
Know it.
So we'll see. We'll see. I'd be happy to reassess that after the launch.
Good question.
Yeah, cheers.
Thank you for that. Pretty sweet.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'd like to take a temporary break from the... what was I trying to say before? Question?
Extravagabadabas. Oh, were you trying to say extravaganza?
Yeah, I was like extraordinaire and extravaganza. I put them together in my mind and in my mouth.
Extraordaganza.
Well, I'd like to take a break from that. Temporarily, though, only to bring you the good news of the world in terms of technology.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thanks, Hill.
Here are the top stories from the Category 5.tv newsroom. Music website Last.fm is investigating the leak of some of its members' passwords, the UK-based company has said. A message posted on the site's homepage advised all of its customers to change their passwords immediately as a precautionary measure. The breach follows similar leaks at social network LinkedIn and the dating site eHarmony. Last.fm apologized, saying it took user privacy very seriously, and added, "We will never email you a direct link to update your settings or ask you for your password. We strongly recommend that your new Last.fm password is different to the password that you use on other services."
That's crazy.
Wild.
I don't understand that, because I'm programming the new Category 5.tv, and the first thing I did with your viewer passwords is I encrypted them. I can't
Smart.
Read them. Nobody can read them. If you know your password, you can log in. but there's no way to reverse it. It's a mm-hmm. non-reversible, hashed, encrypted password.
Smart.
With salt. Little dash of salt. So I don't understand when a big company like that can have a breach. Sounds to me, though, they're saying they wouldn't send the email, so maybe it was a phishing scam.
Yeah.
We got to be careful of that kind of stuff. You get an email that says, hey, log into your last FM account, click here. And you go there and you log in and you're mm-hmm. actually giving your password to somebody else. Sounds like that may be what has happened from what you're saying there.
Yikes. Scary. Crazy. Scary stuff.
Careful, people.
On to some wild stuff now.
Oh, UK good. I love that game.
Researchers have developed a porous material that can preferentially soak up CO2 from the atmosphere. NOT2O2 is a metal organic framework that works like a sponge, absorbing a number of gases at high pressures. But as the pressure is reduced, CO2 is retained as other gases are released. The development reported in Nature Materials holds promise for carbon capture and storage, or even the removing of CO2 from the exhaust gases of power plants and factories.
Cool.
Rural communities across Africa may soon benefit from improved water supplies thanks to mobile phone technology. UK researchers have developed data transmitters that fit inside hand pumps and send text messages if the devices break down. The smart hand pumps will be trialed shortly in 70 villages in Kenya.
That's weird. I wonder how that'll work.
Interesting.
How many people? Like, just judging by the picture there, I wonder how many people have a smartphone.
It's hard to say. It's pretty wild.
Yeah.
We shall see.
We'll see.
And lastly, Apple has unveiled its latest mobile operating system, the iOS 6, at the annual Worldwide Developers Conference. The operating system, which runs on its iPhone, iPad, and iPod Touch devices, will no longer include Google Maps software. Apple will run instead its own mapping app, which has a high-quality 3D mode on the platform. Google announced its own 3D mapping software last week on its competing mobile platform, Android. Both companies have used fleets of planes to capture the imagery, drawing some concerns from some privacy campaigners. Apple's chief executive Tim Cook said that the updated iOS software is being released in beta today and will be available for the general consumers no later than this fall. You can get the full stories online at category5.tv/newsroom. The category5.tv newsroom is researched by Roy W. Nash with contributions from our awesome community viewers. If you have a news story you think's worthy of on-air mention, send us an email at newsroom@category5.tv. For the category5.tv newsroom, I'm Hillary Rumble.
Pyrus Rock. If we don't talk about iOS 6, everyone's going to say, why didn't you mention this? Big news.
It is big news.
Think so.
No problem.
Joking around in the chat room, you guys. Hey, tonight the show is brought to you by Quarterly Electric, the electrical company of Category 5 Technology TV. Check them out, quarterlyelectric.com. If you're in the Central Ontario, Simcoe County, Barrie, Orillia area, make sure you give them a call, all right? quarterlyelectric.com. Also, boost your immunity with GardenGateFarms.com's certified organic broccoli sprout and wheatgrass juice. GardenGateFarms.com. This is Category 5 Technology TV, and I'm Robbie Ferguson.
I'm Hillary Rumble, coming at you with more questions for our viewer questions.
Like a whirlwind, coming at you.
Extravaganza. Extraordinary-aganza.
That was almost a wrap. Coming at you like a whirlwind. I want to hear that.
Someday, maybe. Yeah. We can do that.
Check. News. Check.
Add rap to that. Write rap.
Really cheesy rap segment?
Someday.
Got it. No, I'm just checking off that we did it. It's everything here is scripted, folks. So, yeah.
We make it look so easy, don't we?
We make it look really like everything just happens. And
we're pros. Hello. Yeah.
Very good actors.
Ha ha.
I actually have a full head of hair.
Yep. Our makeup crew did that. Anyway, onward and upward.
And yes, we have one of those, don't we?
Hair and makeup, hello.
Once in a while, my wife will come down and say, oh, that pimple is horrible, let me dab it. That's the makeup crew. I wish she'd do that more often.
What a hoot.
Yeah.
Well, as we expand, who knows what will happen.
These are my real eyebrows. Sorry.
Okay.
All right.
Focus here. Okay. Jim Unroe.
Hey, Jim.
Sent us an email and wanted to indicate how to pronounce his last name. Unroe, like backwards in a rowboat, row forward, and unrow backwards. Thank you for that clarification.
Excellent for the triceps.
I appreciate it. Anyway, Jim's saying, Robbie, has something happened to your RSS feeds. I used to be able to get your podcast on my tablets using the dog catcher. I can search, find, and add the Cat 5 podcast fine. The episodes and sizes of each are listed as expected. But when I select an episode to download, whatever downloads in a second or two is not watchable. Any ideas as to why?
Yeah. See, here's something kind of interesting, and this actually plays into Hung Zhang's question,
okay.
Comment about the and how I was talking about the alt feeds. Here's a great opportunity, Jim. You probably will want to use the alt feeds on that device. Here's what happens: our RSS feeds are designed for synchronization, aggregation, syndication. Okay, so your device, be it an aggregator like Miro Internet TV or iTunes, depending on your platform, is meant to download the episode and then you synchronize it to your device and watch it, or watch it on your computer. Because you're actually accessing the feed directly on your device, what's happening is that it's trying to stream to your device, which unfortunately with the feed, here's where some of the things get a little technical. That's not possible because there are blocks at blip.tv that prevent that from happening, because they think that it's somebody circumventing advertising and things like that. So, pardon me. So you can either aggregate it and then synchronize it to your device rather than trying to watch it from the RSS feed directly on your device through Dogcatcher, or you can use our mobile website, m.cat5.tv. There it is. Right? That's another way you can do it. Or you could add the RSS feed of choice to your add it to your aggregator, synchronize, or you could become a part of the alt feed when it comes out, the alternate RSS feed. So, all right. So you could try that,
okay.
And let me know. I'll be happy to hook you up with that. Anybody who's on the V3 beta would be able to access that. Is Jim in the chat room right now? Because I'd be happy to paste that in.
Just having a look-see, and I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
So, I don't know.
Jim, let us know.
If you are, that's great, but if he's not, then he can access this later.
Sure. What I'll do, Jim, I'm going to post the link to the alternate SD H.264 feed into the chat logs, into the chat room, and it's logged at exactly 7:38 p.m. Okay? So just scroll down in the chat logs, and you'll be able to get that. That's the one that you'll want to subscribe to. That's the alt feed, and it's being built as we speak.
Cool.
So you'll see that the episodes will show up there within the next couple of days.
All right. Good plan.
Thanks, Jim.
All right. Another question here from Dania, saying, I was trying to back up my Windows file from Ubuntu Live CD, which booted from a 2GB Transcend USB flash drive, but the hard disk for Windows won't show up, not even from System Monitor / File Systems, when I click on the home folder. So I tried the sudo fdisk I in Terminal, but what appeared was all of... Oh, L.
Maybe L for
that
list,
is L.
Yeah.
Sorry, that's L. And then she's posted in here a bunch of stuff. So, is there anything I should do after this terminal thing to make my Windows hard disk files detectable? I don't understand why the terminal's, what it's saying, except for the megabyte part, which might be my USB flash drive or something. I really don't know. My info is based on Ubuntu System Monitor, and then she lists that info there, and goes on to say something about can't even do it from safe mode. I don't know, the recovery CD.
Yeah, you're trying to, so you've booted up on a live CD. You want to access your Windows hard drive. What's nice about Linux is that it can read and write to Windows and Linux drives, so you can copy files around. It makes migration very, very easy. So I think that the step that you're missing is, yeah, you can see your partitions there. I don't have a Windows drive in my system. But let's just say it was SDB1, all right? So let's say that it was coming up there. So the steps then Oh, I have an SDB one. But of course, you can't access that device because there's no mount point for it. You haven't created a mount point. So let's say it was, let's just say it was SDC one because I don't have one. I'm going to go sudo mkdir / mnt, or no, let's do media / SDC one. I've now created a mount point for that. Okay, you got to type it like that. Sudo makes you a super user so that you can add something to the media folder, because you have to be super user in order to do that. Makedir means make directory. It's like the DOS MD command. And then the directory that you want to create, SDC1, which is now an empty folder in / media. See, it's just empty. So now what I can do is I can go sudo mount dev SDC1 / media SDC1, because I've created that mount point. Now, if I do that, it's going to say that SDC1 doesn't exist. I'm just using that as the example. But then, pardon me, if I were to do an ls on my SDC1, I would actually have access to it. So then you can navigate there by using, going into your home folder, go up to your file system or whatever, / media / SDC1, and you'd actually be browsing. And I got to that by hitting Control L. Okay? You'd actually be browsing that hard drive. I think that's what you're asking. I think the step is that you're expecting that the drive would be immediately accessible when you boot up, mm-hmm. but it's not, because you haven't mounted it yet. And because it's not an installed operating system, it's not in your FS tab. So you're basically getting access to the CD, and if you plug in a hot swappable USB device, you'll get access to that. But your Windows drive is not going to be accessible until you manually mount it, because you're using a live CD. Hmm. When you've done that, great way to recover from a virus on Windows or something. If your system is wiped out and you need to get files from the hard drive, or you can't boot it, let's say you can't boot a Windows system, you can then boot up into Linux on a live CD without damaging anything on your computer. You can access that and copy everything through your network to a backup drive, through to a NAS or something like that. And it's brilliant.
So good idea.
Good luck. Let us know if it works. Please submit a viewer testimonial if it does. If it doesn't, I don't want to hear about it. Oh, I'm so kidding.
That's hilarious. Mm. But yeah, viewer testimonial, P.S. Do that, because we love to read them. And that's on our website.
Hint, hint.
Nudge, nudge. Say yeah. No more.
All right.
Okay.
Thanks for the question, by the way.
Yes, thank you. Another question here coming to us from Ignacio. Saying, hi, I'm trying to implement Clippy J's in my webpage based on the Cat5 tutorial. What I did so far was to add to my header.php like this, inserts the info and the body, puts all that in there too.
Oh, maybe this is one for me to bring
up. I think so, because I'm not going to read all that. All right. And I also downloaded some more ink clippies, but I'm not really sure where to extract it.
Okay.
So, maybe
Clippy.js.
What? Okay, I was just saying Clippy J's.
Clippy J's. It's because you're in rapper mode.
I think so.
It's your rapper name now.
Clippy J's. I'm clearly, yeah, sorry. And I can't read. Clippy J's.
She's even holding her hand like this.
I'm so embarrassed. Okay.
I don't know what that meant. So if, you know, I don't know what. So if it meant something rude, then I'm very, very sorry.
Clippy J's, okay.
I'm not that hip. I don't really know. Okay, Clippy JS.
Well, that makes a little bit more sense, don't it?
Oh, gotta love it. A JavaScript version of Clippy for your website. Hello there, Clippy.
Oh, I get it.
And you can add him to your website. They've made it look like Microsoft Word. But how cool is that? I mean, it's so uncool. Yeah, Clippy has always been incredibly uncool. But somehow nostalgia
makes
says
cool.
That bringing it back on a website is incredibly cool. Merlin is there, too. That's the one I used to use when I was playing with it. Nice that it has sound. What do you think of that? So this is a free JavaScript library. That's what JS sounds means.
Oh, okay.
So, there you have it. So let's grab Clippy. So you can download that. Let's see what's in the file. So what's being said there is that sounds like you've copied all the code that you're supposed to copy, but then it's not doing anything because you haven't got these files where they're supposed to go. So I'm actually going to take a look at that email. Okay, so yes, all right. So this is what they have done. I gotta be careful here because it's an email.
I can't believe I was thinking. I don't even know what I was thinking.
I don't know.
Clippies. I was like, I thought it was like I thought it was like some sort of clip art thing. Right. I didn't think Clippy the.
So here's the thing, just to understand what this script is doing. This is JavaScript, okay? And what it's telling it is, okay, first of all, load jQuery 1.7. All right. Then that's the library. Then load Clippy minified.js. So what's happening to you here, because you've downloaded the file, the zip file, but you haven't put it anywhere, you haven't extracted it. What it's saying is, okay, well, this is relative to the current folder. So wherever you've saved this file, it's looking for jQuery 1.7 minified.js. Okay, that file. So that needs to be in the current folder, and so does clippymin.js. That has to be in the current folder according to your current structure, but you might want to put it in like a JS folder or something like that. Would probably be the way that I would go. So let's go back to the website. Let's grab that file, download clippy.js. There it is. So you see that it's a folder, right? So let's say I extract that to my desktop, the folder itself. Okay, so now I have that folder. So here is the folder structure, and you'll see that in SRC is usually where they are. You've got the agents, you've got Q. Okay, so no Clippy or jQuery. So let's see if we can find it. There's Clippy. There's Clippy Min. So those are the two that you need. You'll notice that there's something missing. It's jQuery. It's required by the software. So what we'll do, I'm going to recommend that you do this. Go to Google, type in Google jQuery API. Let's get it from the libraries. You're going to tap into, click on jQuery over on the right, and you'll see jQuery, what were you looking for? 1.7. Perfect. Okay. So we want the minified version. What that means is that it's a smaller file because they've removed some of the cruft. Okay, so copy that. All right. And what we want to do is we, in fact, I'm going to bring back up that email here. Okay, there it is. Where it says jQuery 1.7 min.js, I want to paste what I just copied from Google's API. All right. So that is right there. I've copied that to my clipboard. I'm going to paste that. So now it's not a relative file at all. It's not saved on my server. It's actually going to grab it from Google APIs. Okay? So now you've got jQuery, and you need to have clippymin.js in the current folder of your file. And that's probably going to call a whole bunch of stuff. This is the thing, right? You almost need to understand a little bit about JavaScript. And that's probably why they've included, see, the minified version is going to be really, really tough to understand. If I bring that up in text editor, that's what it looks like, okay? Very hard to understand the format. It's compressed. So let's instead close that, and let's bring up the non-compressed version, the non-minified version, and you'll see that this one actually makes sense. It's indented. It makes sense. So one of the things that I would do is I would look for whether it's calling any of these agents. And you can follow the instructions, but you'll see that, it's using a base path on that server, for example. So you're going to need to do some testing, I think, but that's, I think, square one, is getting those two JS files up and running and then follow the directions on the website. I love that. I think that's really cool in kind of a weird, nostalgic way.
The memories.
Clippy.js.
Oh. The memory.
Yeah, hey, if you want to check it out, it's s'more.com. That's what I'm seeing here.
S'more, like the kind
like,
to eat.
Give me some more. No, it's S-M-O-R-E .com. Let's see if we can find it just by going there. Oh, nope. So go slash clippy-js and end bracket. All right.
Cool.
Good luck. Let us know how that goes.
He's in the chat room, so I was I was asking if it made sense.
I hope that it does.
So.
You're calling those files. You're saying, here's the file that I need, jQuery and Clippy.js. If the files aren't in the current folder, you need to tell it where they are, whether they're in the JS folder. So then you would go .js/clippy.js, right? So think in terms of your file system. Your server has a file system. It's Linux-based, so it's going to be relative to the current folder. Unless you have a slash at the beginning, then it's going to be relative to the first folder of the server. If that makes sense from client side.
He said thanks.
Yeah, Ignacio, thank you for the question.
Mm-hmm.
Cheers, I hope that helps.
Cool.
And I love that. Thanks for giving us that, Clippy.js. That's something cool for the community to check out.
For
how do you
the
like
memories.
That? I can just see this is going to end up on Garby's store website somehow. Somehow, Garby, it's going to happen.
It's possible. Very cool.
This is Category 5 Technology TV. We're online, www.category5.tv. Love to have you join us on that website. And we're going to be replacing it with a brand new one come July 1st. So don't be scared when you see how awesome it is. It's going to be even gooder.
Embrace change.
Embrace it.
Change is a good thing. And I'm changing it up. Mm-hmm. Not really. I'm asking another question.
Oh, good.
This comes to us from a different Robbie. To Robbie from Robbie
this
Jacobson.
Is creepy. Hey.
There's more than one.
We got a Robbie Ferguson and a Robbie Jacobson. We should start a band.
I wonder where he's from. Might not work. Might not work. This is a follow-up from a previous question that he's asked.
All right.
So I'm not actually sure which episode
what
this was
did I break?
From.
What did I break?
Okay. I think that my question must have been unclear before.
Okay.
I have Wi-Fi encrypted with WPA2. The problem is that Ubuntu continually asks for the password for the Wi-Fi. I've put in the password and I am able to connect with my Mac, just not my Ubuntu system. This is a similar problem that other people have posted in the Ubuntu forums. So I guess he must have sent in a question previously about a Wi-Fi encryption.
Last week
problem.
We were talking about. I see. So I misunderstood. It wasn't that you were trying to access your network without a password. It's that it kept coming up. And I think I mentioned in the course of the discussion there last week that one of the things that I would try, and I would recommend it especially now that I know that, if you're being prompted for your password over and over and over again, it means maybe your network interface controller, your Wi-Fi card, is having issues with the particular encryption protocol that you're using. WPA, try WPA2. If you're using WPA2, try WPA. Don't go with WEP. I've talked about that last week. And make sure that your router is not in a mixed mode kind of scenario. That might be causing trouble as well. If your system is unable to detect whether it's WPA or WPA2 and your router is set to mixed between the two, like WPA or WPA2. So set it to one or the other. Set up a password. Try it. And if that one doesn't work, try the other. So between those two, give that a try. And Robbie, let me know how it goes, all right? Thanks, dude.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Dun, da, da, da. I have another question.
We're getting tons of band names here, Robbie, in the chat room. I suggested Robbie Squared, because there's two of us.
Makes sense.
That might work. But then what if we want to have someone else join the band?
They would have to as a
Robbie.
Prerequisite.
Well, we're talking about nostalgia tonight. You know, back in the 80s, it was Tony, Tony, Tony. So we'll be Robbie, Robbie, Robbie. There you go.
I think it could work.
That could work.
I think it could work.
It'll be pretty awesome. We'll have a couple of hits, and then we'll disappear.
Yep, I think that's pretty sweet.
R&R we got from Dave Maiden. That's pretty good. I could use some of that.
You and me both.
It would be really mellow music, though.
It put everyone to sleep. Totally. Well, I'm just wondering if we have time for possibly one more email.
All right, we'll give it a go.
Okay, this is from Dave Maydoom. Hey, Robbie, and whoever it is on this week.
It's Hillary.
Okay, Hillary. Thanks for the shout out last week after my operation and short stay in the hospital. It made me smile. Anyway, as I mentioned you on Twitter. I've now got my media PC running Ubuntu 10.04 LTS at the present.
Fantastic.
And hooked up to my 32-inch LCD HDTV.
Wonderful.
At 1080p and full surround sound. And oh boy, it's like having you guys in the same room.
Terrible.
Here's a photo I've taken of Cat 5.
You get so annoyed with me.
Running on my TV and smaller device. Okay. And my smaller device is an Acer Aspire 1 netbook.
That's awesome.
Sweet.
What a great setup. I mean, the fact that you can catch an online-only television program from Ontario, Canada, and pick it up, and there it is on the bio.
Cool.
But there it is up on the 32-inch screen. Just the fact that this is doable in today's landscape still blows my mind.
You can do anything.
It's amazing. Very cool.
Yeah.
Dave, 100 viewer points.
What do you say here? As you can see, since November 2009, I've come a long way. What a true fan, upgrading his own stuff, you know?
And us in surround sound. So,
yeah.
Dave, this is for
Pretty
you.
Sweet.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Hello, Dave.
Hello, Dave.
Dave, I'm over here.
Hey, Dave. What's up?
Dave, nice to see you.
Oh, Dave. Oh, Dave. Dave from Dudley, West Midlands, UK.
That was really awesome.
Sweet.
Put on your headphones if you want to know what that's all about. I promised you that I would take a quick look tonight. There it is.
Dun, da, da, da.
The Water 2.0 Pro. Now, we're actually going to be reviewing this in the near future. Let's see if I can get a close-up. There it is. What is so awesome about this? From Thermaltake. I mean, we already know. I mean, Thermaltake is... their slogan is cool all your life. Really, it's just your computer. But it adds coolness factor because it's so awesome.
True. So, double, like, play on words.
One of the things about getting good system performance is having a good cool processor, having good cool internal components. So, I use liquid cooling in my system, and it looks like this.
Cool.
Yeah. Literally. And you got to be really careful. Really careful. As you pour that into your computer. Or, you know, I use a siphon.
Smart.
But there's a lot of fear that comes in that kind of liquid cooling system. A lot of trouble that could happen in that, you know, what if it evaporates over time? What if you don't fill it in time? Could be an issue. Along comes the amazing Water 2.0 from Thermaltake. There we go. Let's crack into this.
Great.
What is so different about this, Hill? All right, here's the unboxing.
Let's see. There we go.
There you go. Oh, yes. Not overpackaged, which is
nice.
And recyclable material. Okay. There's our water block. Brilliant. Cool. It's got thermal compound already on there. Now, here is what is different about this. What do you notice? There is no liquid.
Yeah.
Yet this is a liquid cooling system with an incredible high efficiency radiator and a very nice water block with copper. But here's the thing, it's low profile. So we talk about the fact that you want to have a very cool system. What happens here is because this is so low profile to your system, it allows the airflow within your system to kind of be a lot better. What's really cool about this, it's adjustable. You can move things around, make it work within your system, but everything, liquid, everything is self-contained. There's no having to refill it. In the entire lifetime of the product, you will never have to refill this. It is entirely self-contained water cooling. It has 220 millimeter fans. These are Thermaltake fans. You know they're ultra quiet. One goes on the back, one goes on the front, blows out the back of your system, blows air over the radiator fins, cooling the liquid, and then going over your CPU. Which CPUs is this compatible with? Well, this is the newest line from Thermaltake, so you know that they're looking at compatibility, and this is compatible with every Intel processor on the market and every AMD processor that's available on the market.
Cool.
You're not going to have any trouble with compatibility. You'll see it comes with brackets for everything.
This is just the tip of the iceberg.
Just the tip of the iceberg.
Stay tuned for next time to see.
Very easy to install. We're going to actually do it live on the air just to show you how easy it is. We're going to bring down the temperature of a standard system. Fact is, I mean, if you are using a stock fan that came with your system, you're probably running a lot hotter than you need to be. Mm-hmm. This will reduce your temperatures by 20, maybe 30%, which is going to therefore just give you better performance, less strange crashing from heat issues. It's fantastic. But that it's self-contained, no liquid that you have to fill, and it's not going to leak. You don't have to worry about drips in your system or anything like that. You don't have to worry about evaporation.
Oh, I look forward to learning more.
Mm.
It's going to rock.
It's been fun having everybody here.
It's been a slice.
Nice having you here.
Thank you.
Time flies, doesn't it?
Sure do. Boy, oh boy. What a riot.
What a riot, folks. Thanks for being here. Check out our website, category5.tv. Thanks to our beta testers who are helping me to develop the V3 website. We're going to be going into phase 3 this week, which means they can start posting screenshots. They can start talking all about it and blogging about it. Very exciting time for Category 5 as we launch our brand new ultra-fast content distributed network website. So looking forward to that. Just over 2 weeks' time.
Sounds good.
Thanks, everybody. Have a fantastic week, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.